Okay, so hello everyone and welcome to the 12th session of the online Optom learning series. So let me introduce to you the speaker for today. We have Mr. Nooruz Zaman. He finished his bachelor's as well as master's and he holds the fellowship of the IACL. Currently, he's working at the Shankara Eye Foundation as an assistant professor as well as the consultant optometrist. He's currently also pursuing his PhD and he is going to talk to us about the recent advances in the management of dry eye. So sit back and let's have a fruitful learning session today. Okay, Noor, go ahead.
Once again, good morning, everyone. So today I'm going to discuss on the recent advances in the management of dry eye. So when we talk of dry eye, we have been seeing that this is a most common problem which affects general population. As per a study, which says that this is going to be one of the leading cause for the patient visit to the eye care. And the problem may range from mild, moderate, or to the severe. So actually, when we talk of this disease, it can affect young adults as well as elderly population. As per a recent dry eye workshop, which was held in 2017, which says that the dry eye usually happens because of two major responsible features like tear film hyperosmolarity and the tear film instability. Whenever there is a tear film hyperosmolarity or the tear film instability, they affect the inflammatory cells and leads to a damage to the ocular surface. When these damages happens, it can leads to a visual disturbance or the discomforts of the dry eye that we see in the day-to-day practice as the symptoms for the patient. Now, in short, what we can say that dry eye is the dryness of cornea and the conjunctiva, which is triggered by tear film instability and the tear film hyperosmolarity. There has been a various other names for the dry eye like keratoconjunctivitis sicca, keratitis sicca, xerophthalmia, dry eye syndrome, ocular surface disease, dysfunctional tear dysfunction. So all these factors are frequently occurred conditions in our clinical practice and can affect the patient's quality of life as well as can decrease the productivity at the workplace. So we have to be careful when we are dealing with the patients in our clinics, because this is the numbers and the prevalence of the dry eye is increasing each passing day. Dry eye is mainly revolve around a tear film which covers the ocular surface of our eye. The tear film is actually a three-layered structure. The superficially, the oily layer is a layer which lubricates and prevents the evaporation. And it is secreted by a meibomian gland or some of the accessories glands like Zeiss and the Mohs. Below the lipid layer, we have the aqueous or the watery layer, which nourishes and protects the cornea. It contains metabolites, micronutrients. It also has the antimicrobial properties into them. So they gives additional benefits during any kind of inflammatory reactions, or also it prevents the infection. The innermost layer is the mucin layer, a mucoid layer, which is secreted by goblet cells present on to the conjunctiva. Their role is to adhere the tears to the ocular surface and make the tear film intact onto the surface. They also helps in the maintaining the stability of the tear film. Thus, we can say the proper coordination of the tear film is very important in order to smooth functioning of the eye or the ocular surface. What we can conclude, the studies or the evidence says that usually a volume of the tear film is 7 to 10 microliter, and that can go higher during unblinked condition. Thickness can vary. Our thickness is usually a 7 micron. The tears are produced at the rate of 1.2 microliter per minute, and the evaporative rate at 30% of the humidity is 0.2 one for microliter per minute. pH varies between 6.5 to 7.6. And the surface tension, which is actually a cohesion force, which helps the liquid to bind with this particle, is 40.7 dyne per centimeter. Refractive index is 1.336. And the osmolarity is 300 to 310 milliosmoles per liter. So what happens usually in the dry eye, if it's not a reflex tearing, so the volume, thickness, and the production can go down. The evaporation rate of the tear will go up during a dry or the less humid situation. pH again can go up. Surface tension can go down. Osmolarity of the tears may increase. So our diagnostic tools or the test usually revolves around these parameters. We try to check in our day-to-day clinic what is the amount of the tear film. So therefore, the normative values of the tear is very essential for us to know. Epidemiologically, if we see the studies, it has a very variable range, which has been done on the hospital-based population as well as a population-based studies, which says that the prevalence can vary between 5 to 93.2% to some of the population. In India, it usually varies between 18.4 to 40.8. again, it is a huge range, and it is more prevalent in the Asian countries where situation or the geographically they are dry or less humid. Again, the possible reason for this variability could be a geographical location. We have seen that the dry eye, the prevalence of dry eye varies between the based on the geographical situation. Like it is more higher in the dry or hot conditions. There has been no gold standard for detecting or predicting a dry eye. So variable diagnostic criteria has been used in various studies. So that could be also a possible reason for underestimating or overestimating the dry eye. There has been a lack of standardization in the population, because we will see that the various population, various conditions can also be a responsible factor for the dry eye or the risk factor for the dryness. Before understanding the management or the diagnosis, let's have a look on how can we classify dry eye. So as per a dry eye workshop of 2017, they beautifully classified dry eye into two categories. One could be a aqueous deficient, or other can be a evaporative dry eye. So since we have already discussed that it is a multifactorial, it can also be possibility that aqueous deficient, apart from the aqueous deficient, person can also have the evaporative dry eye. So let's take the aqueous deficient. So aqueous, when we talk of aqueous deficient, it can be a Sjogren syndrome kind of dry eye. A nature can be primary or secondary. When we say that it's a Sjogren and the secondary, the root cause could be connective tissue disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, or polymyositis, or scleroderma. So connective tissues leading to a Sjogren syndrome, or the lacrimal gland productivity, it is a secondary reasons or the secondary Sjogren syndrome dry eye. Other possible reason could be a non-Sjogren dry eye, where a lacrimal deficiency happens. It could be age-related changes in the lacrimal gland, where the production of the lacrimal gland or the lacrimal is less, or it can also be in the congenital alacria, where the absence of lacrimal gland is there. Other reasons can be a lacrimal gland obstructions. Usually we see this in the trachoma, Steven-Johnson syndrome, chemical or the thermal injuries. Sometimes reflex blocks are also being experienced, or could be a possible reason. Usually that happens in the keratitis, especially a neurotrophic keratitis. Post-infection of the herpes could also block the reflex. Contact lens can also decrease the reflex and decreases the sensitivity of the cornea. apart from that, the corneal surgeries, especially the refractive surgeries or the keratoplasty, could also be a possible reasons for giving rise to a reflex plaque block leading to a non-Sjogren's kind of syndrome, which could be a aqueous deficient. There has been a various other systemic drugs also, which leads to dryness, especially the related to the lacrimal gland. This could be antihypertensive drugs, antidepressants, antihistamines. So persons under these kind of medications should also be taken care for the dry eye or for the dryness. Other possible reason for the dryness is the evaporative, and the study says that more than 85% of the dry eye is because of the evaporative in nature. So the evaporative dry eye, we discussed that it could be because of the meibomian gland. So it can be intrinsic as well as extrinsic. When we say intrinsic, the internal factors could be meibomian oil deficiencies or dysfunction in the meibomian gland. And this disinfection or what you call deficiency can be a congenital in nature, or it could be because of any kind of inflammation to the eyelid, like blepharitis, trachoma, any kind of burns. Lid disorders could also be a possible reasons for the evaporative dry eye that happens in the lid palsies or the exophthalmos. Low blink rate are experienced in many conditions like Parkinson's disease or a person's heavily dependent on the digital screen or the digital devices. So they also a possible reason that these computer or the digital screen can reduce the blink rate, and which can ultimately disturb the tear film stability and can cause a evaporative dry eye. Some drugs like Accutane is actually a form of vitamin A, which reduces the oil by blocking the glands. So this is used for the treatment of the acne. So what happens when somebody is on Accutane? So apart from the cutaneous glands, it can also block the meibomian gland, because the secretion for the meibomian is also oil. So when this deficiency in the meibomian oil happens, the evaporation rate through the ocular surface increases, and it leads to a dry eye. Some extrinsic factors like vitamin A deficiency that we see in xerophthalmia, topical preservatives. The preservatives present in the topical drugs could also be a possible reasons for the dry eye that we see in the anti-glaucoma, or somebody is on anti-allergic for a long period of time, can also lead to a evaporative dry eye. Ocular surface allergies like conjunctivitis is one other factor. So what we saw through this diagram or through this slide, that dry eye has a multifactorial nature. The risk factor for the dry eye is very large. So therefore, we as a clinician or eye care practitioner should be aware of what could be the possible threat to the eye, what could be the possible threat for the patient to have a dry eye. So our treatment should be a preventive as well as surgical or the therapeutic or the therapies. So we will see that what are the different management options. But before that, when the patient come to us, they comes with the some of the symptoms. So discomfort, hyperemia, foreign body sensation or the gritty sensation, burning of sensation, watering, blurring of vision, or sometimes intolerance to the contact lenses are also being reported. And if you can see that the symptoms are very familiar or similar to some of the common problems that we see in day-to-day practice, which makes the diagnosis more challenging. Like it has also been seen in the various literature or in our day-to-day practice, that there lack of association between the sign and the symptoms. It means when a patient comes, many a times they come with this symptom, and during our clinical test or investigation, we fail to identify it as a dry eye, especially when it's a mild. Also, this symptoms that we see in the dryness or the dry eye is very familiar or common to some of the conditions like blepharitis, conjunctival infection, or the refractive error. Also, there is lack of consistency and the reliability of the test. So therefore, what we should be doing whenever we are seeing a patient, we should be thoroughly examining the patient. Like we should be looking for the eyelid, conjunctival sac, or bulbar conjunctiva, or the cornea. Whenever we are looking for that, we should look for the eyelid margin, eyelashes, infection, lid closure, any signs of abnormalities, any signs of gland disorder, any signs of blepharitis could be reported, and this could be a possible threat to the dry eye. Another thing that we should be seeing is the conjunctival sac. Usually what happens during a dry eye, the tear films, the volume or the secretion of the tear films can go down, and it can decrease, and the tear meniscus can be seen negligible or very less. So seeing or examining or measuring the tear meniscus height, this can be also be indication for the dry eye. Look for the debris discharge, because that also are reasons that also are common indications for the dry eye, and that will also rule out the other possible reasons for the discomfort. During a inspection of the bulbar conjunctiva, look for the lusterness. Usually it becomes a hyperemia, it becomes muddy or slightly, it loses its luster. Vital to spot can also be reported in cases of vitamin A deficiency or xerophthalmia. So when we are looking for that, we should be carefully identifying and inspecting all the possible threat. Cornea becomes a lusterless, it can become a hazy in certain situation. Stain the eye and look for the SPKs. That could also be indications or the early signs for any possible inflammation and the infection. And that could also be are seen in the dry eye patient. If the person or if you see a scar onto the cornea, so that is again a reason for the dryness. So our diagnostic tail or test usually revolve around some of the common factors. Like when we test or when we do a clinical test, our aim is to measure or identify the tear secretion. We can also work towards the volume of the tears. Okay, what is the nature and the current status of the volume? Tear clearance, how much tear is getting drained out of the eye. Stability of the tear film and the extent of the ocular surface damage. All these possible factors, or the combination of tests can be done in order to find out a true cause or the reliable dryness. For this, various tool has been used or around us. It can be in the form of subjective or the objective test. When we talk of the subjectives, the self-assessment questionnaire or various other questionnaires are available with us. We can use these questions based on our patient's population or the nature of our practice. So some are very good for measuring the environmental or the occupational conditions. Some are good for measuring the contact lens induced dryness. So these ocular surface disease index or a Sunday or speed, McMoney's, and I'm sure there are many more questionnaires. So you should look for the questionnaires that suits your working situation. There has been various other objective tests also, which can be non-invasives or minimal invasives. So they are being into practice since many years. So these possible objective tests are actually a tear film breakup time, which usually measures the tear film stability, and that can be invasive as well as uninvasive. Care should be taken when we are using an invasive test or when we are using any saline in order to dilute the fluorescent strip, that it should be preservative free. Second test is the Schirmer test or the phenol red thread test. Usually it measures the tear secretion. The basal as well as the reflex tearing can be measured through them. And a strip or the thread is inserted down to the lower fornix and the wet length are measured. But the reliability of the Schirmer is again a question mark. Again, another test that we perform and we should be doing that, the ocular surface staining, because we know that the ocular surface disorders occurs in the condition of a dry eye. We could, because of this, we could possibly identify and early detect the dry eye. So therefore, staining can be done. All the possible stains like fluorescein, rose bengal, or the lysamine green can be used for this. And the grading, you can opt a different grading system, or there has been a various grading system. You can opt a grading system to grade the extent and the nature of the damage. Meibomian gland dysfunction or the functionality tests like meibography or the meibom expression can also be a one test where you can find out the meibomian gland dysfunction, where you can measure the evaporative nature of the dry eye. Some of the tests, a lab test like tear osmolarity, or there has been a few of the non-invasive tests like tear lab osmometer, which gives a more quick, results, can also be used to quantify the tear film osmolarity. And we know that in the dry eye, the tear osmolarity goes up. So that could also be one of the quick method to identify a dryness. Tear film interferometry is also being performed. So usually that is done by lipid view or the tear scope, which measures the thickness of the lipid layer and also gives us the idea of the quality of the tear film present onto the eye. Impression cytology is again a minimum invasive test where an impression is taken from the conjunctival goblet cells, and it is inspected on microscopes to look for the glandular changes or cellular changes that have happened to the mucin part of the tear. Another possible test that is getting popular is a tear protein assay, where the tears are taken to the labs and the protein are analyzed for the biomarkers. Usually a matrix metalloproteinase is one protein that it gets increases during our dry eye. So when we are doing or inspecting for the dry eye, so we should be performing a battery of tests, or usually a battery of tests is preferred because there is no gold standard for the dry eye till date. So we can aim for various other diagnostic method in order to confirm our diagnostics. So therefore, because the accuracy is very complex and the accuracy has been questioned in various of the literature, so in order to be more accurate, we should be performing some of the tests for the dryness of the dry eye. When we talk of the management, so usually the management options is based on how we are going to reduce the sign and symptoms of the dry eye, what can be done to maintain and improve the visual function, and also the aim is to reduce and prevent the structural damage that is happening on the ocular surface because of the tear film instability and the hyperosmolarity. Some of the common treatment method which is popular or that can be opted, we as a primary eye care practitioner or healthcare professional, we should be looking for eliminating these factors which is triggering the dry eye. And one possible reason is the topical and the systemic medication. So we should be identifying all those possible threats, and we should be taking a proper measure in order to control, in order to prevent the dryness. Other possible factor is the education and the environmental modification. So these days, or we have literature has already proven that use of digital device decreases the blink rate. and that can lead to a evaporative dry eye. So our aim should be that we should be in, educating the people to minimize the use, to use a correct method for the computer and other things. For that, the rule of 20-20-20 can be educated, or can be people should be made aware of this, how they can prevent some of the problems because of these digital devices. Other could be an environmental modification. Apart from that, smoking is also being proven that whether it's active or the passive smoking, the smoke can also triggers our nerves. It can also lead to a evaporative dry eye, or it can also increases the and changes the stability of the tear film. Another possible reasons or modification that we can aim is the environmental modification. People working in a dry or under AC or a hot climate, they can opt a different modification, like using sunglasses, taking breaks during your work. These could be a few of the preventive measures for the dry eye. Also, if somebody is on a contact lens, or especially when they are working with the less humid situation, so they are going to have a more dryness. So we as an optometrist or the eye care practitioners, when we are dispensing any lenses, the care should be taken to dispense those lenses which has a minimum risk of evaporation through them, which has a minimum risk of creating a dryness or the dry eye. If possible, shift them to these RGPs or the mini scleral. But if you need to prescribe a soft lenses, the care should be taken, and one should be encouraged to dispense a low water content kind of lenses. The scleral lenses has been proven to work tremendously good for the ocular surface diseases, and they has one of the upcoming treatment modalities for the dry eye. Other possible treatment which is very popular is the topical medications, like artificial substitutes in the either in the form of gels and the ointments are also given, and one should be encouraged to give preservative free drops. Also, anti-inflammatory agents like cyclosporin, which has FDA approval for dry eye, so can be cyclosporin A can be increased. Also, a corticosteroids, because of the anti-inflammatory natures of them, they give a symptomatic relief. They helps in the healing and reduces the inflammation occurring because of the ocular surface disorders. Also, the mucolytic agents in the present in the artificial tears can usually works very good, like some of the cellulose derivatives that we know, that carboxymethyl cellulose or hydroxymethyl cellulose or hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, glycerin, polyvinyl alcohol. All these are demulcents in nature. They supports or helps the mucin part of the tear film. So therefore, these drugs or these topical medications helps in increasing the viscosity of the ocular surface, increases the adherence power of the tear to the ocular surface. It can also prevent the evaporation or the tear evaporation. That's in short, we can say that it helps in the healing. It reduces the inflammation. One mode of the artificial tears or the tear substitute can be our autologous serum. The studies have already proven that autologous serum is one of the method for topical medications, and they works very well for the ocular surface disorders. So you can find enough literature which supports that this can be used in the various conditions of a severe or the chronic dry eyes. Dry eye increases the hydration, it decreases the friction, It increases the tear retention onto the ocular surface. That's in short, it decreases the inflammations and gives us symptomatic relief to the patient. Not only this, there has been various other systemic medications like anti-inflammatory agents like cyclosporine or corticosteroids. Apart from that, the fatty acids like omega-3 and the omega-6 has also been proven in the past that they works good and they provides a symptomatic relief during a dry eye. And they can also be helpful in, reducing the inflammation in the dry eye. But recently, some of the studies has also got controversial results that they found that they are not much, effective that was claimed earlier. So major source of omega-3 or omega-6 is actually a flaxseed oil or the fish oils, and which studies nowadays, some of the studies claim that they are equivalent to the placebo effect. So we should be looking for some more literature in order to say that how effective these fatty acids are for the dry eye. So updates are still going on this. Let's see what happens in the coming future, what we get, what results comes out. Apart from that, a surgical intervention can be done in order to treat the disease, treat the dry eye. For that, occlusion of the punctum can be done by using a punctum plug. This can be temporary or it can also be done permanently based on the conditions and the situation. Usually, it helps in retaining the tear film onto the corneal surface by preventing the drainage system. Also, tarsorrhaphy can be done in certain situation where lead abnormalities are there, like lagophthalmos or any kind of burns, injuries. Another thing that has come up is the amniotic membrane transplantation. They are wonderful healing properties. Usually these amniotic membranes are taken from the innermost part of the placenta during a cesarean section. And the best part of this amniotic membrane is that they can be stored up to 1 to 2 years. And they has excellent healing properties because they have the growth factors into them. And because of that, it can give rise to re-epithelialization of the tissues or the structures, especially when there is a compromised stem cells to the cornea because of the injuries, because of the burns, because of any other chronic conditions of the dry eye. Not only this, we can also be looking for the therapies which are getting popular or which has become popular in last few years. Like it has been seen that evaporative dry is the major responsible factor for the dry eye, and more than 85% of the population or the dry eye patient is because of the meibomian gland dysfunction are in evaporative in nature. So the treatment or the management are slightly shifting towards the evaporative conditions of the dry eye, and it has been seen that there are various therapy available with us for the managing the gland dysfunction. One can be a blepharostim, which was the earliest kind of therapy where a goggles was used onto the eye, and it has an eyelid warming sensation or the device which enhance the tear film quality by unblocking the glands and it's changing the nature of the blocked meibum. Another test or the therapy that is popular these days is the lipid flow, which is designed to provide heat and the massage. So usually this cup area rests on the cornea and this goes under the eyelid. What it does, this provides a superficial massage on the outer part of the lid, and this provides on massage or the heat to the inner part. So this is one of the FDA approved therapy, or unique in its own kind because it gives therapies or takes part of the inner as well as the outer part of the eyelid. The test is quick. It also unblocks the meibomian glands and helps the quality of the tear film. This also restores the gland function. So this is encouraged these days for as a therapy for the meibomian gland dysfunction. Another test is the intense pulse light (IPL), where we use a high-powered, pulse or the light. The device is a handheld and it has a flash gun kind of thing. So what it usually is done, it delivers the intense or the visible pulse of the light onto the eyelid margin, and it again unblocks the glands. It again improves the tear film quality. Thus, we can see that there has been a various therapies available with us in order to control the evaporative dry eye or to treat the meibomian gland dysfunction. So you have to be remember the gland which are being lost cannot regenerate. So what is left that is made sure that they are acting or effectively working. So thus, these were some of the treatment options or the management for the dry eye that we should be looking for. So hence, I would like to conclude here based on certain situation, like we as an eye care practitioner or an optometrist, our aim should be to educate people, to create awareness about the disease, and also we should be updating ourselves for the different management and the diagnostic tools, because the nature of the dry eye is a very dynamic. So every time, every year, we are getting some updates and some features of this. So regular updates are happening. So we as a clinician should also update ourselves for a better treatment modalities. Thank you. Be safe and healthy.
Okay, thank you Noor for your very wonderful and the latest treatment options available in dry eye. There are a couple of questions here. Let me just read out for them. Some of them were actually answered during your presentation, so I'm just keeping those questions. Okay, the first question is dry eye related to decreased corneal sensation?
Decreased corneal sensation, it can be vice versa. Decreased corneal sensation can also give rise to a dry eye during a neurotrophic keratitis and other things. Or it can be also another way, like dry eye can also decrease the corneal sensation because of creating changes to the ocular surface. So it can be both.
Okay. How to differentiate watering as dry eye symptom?
Usually, this can be one aspects of looking the dry eye, because in certain situation when the cornea and the ocular surface is compromised, there can be a triggering factor for the reflex tearing. So this reflex tearing contains a water part of it. And usually what happens when there is excessive of the aqueous part of that again disturbs the osmolarity of the surface and can be a reasons for the excessive evaporation. So even though a person is having a reflex tearing or excessive lacrimation of the watering, that could be a possible threat or possible reason for the dry eye. So we should be looking to both aspects. So somebody who is having a excessive water could also be seen as a dry eye.
Okay. And what's your favorite choice of management for a patient with nicbut of 5 seconds both eyes? He complains of photophobia and it becomes difficult even to open the eye at times.
Come again?
There is a patient whose nicbut is 5 seconds. Mm-hmm. And his complaint is photophobia, and the patient cannot open the eyes. So what is Dr. Everett's House of Management?
So we have to see what is the possible reasons for this. So it could be because of, as I mentioned, case photophobia can be because of some other reasons also. So we need to eliminate all those risk factors, or we need to see if there is any kind of discharge that is happening into the eye. So we need to start with the therapeutic drugs for controlling any, or for managing the discharge, which could be a possible reason for the photophobia. For that, you can use a preservative-free drops along with the corticosteroids. That could be one way for me as a clinician to look for the dry eye.
Yeah,
so therapeutic management, I will. Because photophobia involved in it.
Go ahead.
And the, because of the photophobia, we need to see what is the possible reasons for the photophobia. Once we know that, then we can go ahead with the treatment option.
Yeah, because as we also mentioned during your presentation, that it's multifactorial. So first thing is we need to find the cause and then treat the cause appropriately, right? The other question is, decrease in blink rate due to digital device will be placed under which category of classification?
So this can be a evaporative dry eye. Okay, so decrease can come. I mean, it can be other way also, like a decreased blink rate is going to create a excessive evaporation. When the evaporation is happening, the osmolarity is going to change onto the ocular surface. Once the osmolarity is getting changed, the stability of the tear will go down. So it will have a chain of reactions, like it will lead to an inflammation, it will lead to irritations, and again, tear instability. So all these things will keep on happening once we are exposed to a digital device and we have a low blink rate. So I think that will come under the evaporative nature of the dry eye.
Okay, and does hot compression help in the treatment of dry eye?
Yes, many a times it can help us, because again, we need to see what is the root cause of the dry eye. So if it is again because of the gland dysfunction, or because of if you see meibomitis, or if you see a blepharitis. So in that conditions, hot fermentation can work. But if it's aqueous deficient, we need to see some other options or treatment modalities.
And when it comes to punctal plugs, usually they are given in the lower lid or the upper lid, or both?
So both, I mean, they can be given to the... The main aim is to block the tear drainage. So drainage can happen through the both the ducts. So we, our aim should be that blocking the both.
Okay. And what about probing of meibomian gland ducts? How is it convenient to the patient and the practitioners? Do you have any idea about that? Probing of meibomian glands.
So usually probing gland expression is done by pressing the ducts. So that is one. But again, we it is again a question mark, how much one should be expressing that, how much we should be applying the pressure or the heat onto the surface. So usually it is inconvenient, but you require a skills and a proper method in order to express the meibomian glands. That can be done. I mean, that is not a way, but sometimes it becomes inconvenient to some of the patients.
Yeah. And what is blepharostim or lipid flow available in India? Any idea about that?
Yes, very much. They are available in India.
And eyelid therapy is practiced in India?
Yes. There are various organizations that they use this lipid flow or blepharostim or IPL therapies. So they are available. I mean, slightly it is gaining popular. Not everywhere you will find it, because the instrument is quite expensive and the tests and the therapies requires a session. It's not every person can afford, but again, people are getting aware of the situation. People are understanding the root cause and they are going for the therapies. So it is gaining popular day by day.
Okay, and what is your experience, if you have, on the pros contact lens options?
Yes, they work very good. I mean, I feel like, but again, the cost is one factor. Many a times, I mean, patients do not want to go with the contact lenses. They usually want some other options because care and maintaining is another aspect. Especially in some practitioner, they think contact lens in a different way. They could be a possible threat for the infection, and because the care and maintenance has to be very good with the lenses. Yeah. So this is the option, but again, they should be advised with precaution, and not every person can handle it. So once you are dispensing it, make sure that they will be able to manage and handle the lenses.
Okay, let's take last two questions before we close for today. How to diagnose mucin deficiency dry eye?
So mucin deficiency, I mean, grossly, if you on a clinical test, you can use a tear film breakup time, or whether it's invasive or non-invasive. So this can give you the stability, and it has been seen that the stability of the tear film is because of the one possible reason is the mucin deficiency. Other is like if you have the access for the labs where they can do the impression cytology, then the impression of these mucins can be taken and they can look for the changes in happening in the mucin glands. So these two methods, I think, very much are easy and requires a minimum invasions can be done.
Okay. And one last question before we close for today. How does cyclosporine work for dry eyes? Do you have any experience of cyclosporine?
I personally have not, because we are not into the therapeutics part of the management. But again, cyclosporine has an anti-inflammatory properties into them. So usually they provide a healing, helps in the tissue repair. Because we know that in the dry eye, dysfunction of the ocular surface happens. So if the tissue reconstruction or the regeneration of the tissue happens, then automatically the ocular surface will heal up, and the once the surface is getting better, the tear stability and the hyperosmolarity can also improve. So cyclosporine usually gives a symptomatic relief or reduces the symptoms for the dry eye.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Noor, for giving us your time and sharing with us your experience on working with dry eye and what are the various options available in treatment of the same, the dry eye condition. Thank you very much for being a part of
OOLS. Thank you, OOLS. Thank you for Grudin, and thank you everybody who were there today for listening with patience and attention. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. See you.
Welcome, Noor. And let me just show you what we have in store for you tomorrow. So, yeah, tomorrow we have Optom Ranuka Singham. She is an optometrist as well as a certified image and branding consultant. And tomorrow she is going to brief us the customer's experience journey for an optical retail practice. She will also share some tips on how can we improve the professional presence in our practice. So tune in tomorrow, 12:30 p.m. India time and 3 p.m. Malaysia time. I hope to see you all tomorrow. Until then, stay home, stay safe. See you tomorrow. Bye.